It's a pleasure to be here in this forum where all the industry personnel and eminent scientists representing great universities are around. Particularly, I feel very proud to be speaking after Professor Reddanna, being an alumnus of University of Hyderabad myself, although from School of Chemistry, not biology, not the life sciences though. You know, it's a great organization, a great university that, oh, that speaks a lot about our university in itself. So, good morning to all of you. And in the beginning itself, I would like to place my thanks to PharmExcel, particularly to Dr. Uday Bhaskar Garu for giving me this opportunity to come over and speak, although in place of our director, Dr. Chandrasekhar, since he was having some other prior commitment, he couldn't make it. But I'll try to do some justice on his behalf to portray on how IICT has been playing a key role in contributing in the form of technologies in the area of APIs, KSMs and intermediates, both for COVID and also non-COVID as well, and how we contribute with industry. We work together with industry. So moving on with my presentation, the occasion is of course a very powerful one, I would say, Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav, and we truly should celebrate on our achievements and accomplishments. So to a certain extent, I'll be talking also about the success stories that we have had. And that's my organization. This is the pointer, or this is next. So that's a small organogram. For those who are not aware of CSIR, I thought it's essential that I put it up. But for those who know CSIR organization very well, they are aware of this structure. You know, it's a society registered body, Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, and we have, the president is none other than the Prime Minister of the nation. The Science and Technology Minister happens to be the Vice President, and then our DG. That's how it goes with the way we function with the advisory board, the performance appraisal boards, the management council and the research council. That's taken care of by the directors of all the 38 laboratories. I'll give you a picture of what CSIR is. We are now geared up to build CSIR to fulfill the new aspirations of New India, I would say. So you can see the little bit of data here, but it's kind of an intro to people that we are 38 laboratories and several units working together under CSIR. We have a pan-India presence. We work under five different disciplines: biological, chemical, engineering, information and physical sciences, and we are standing as ninth in the Shimago global ranking, and that's for the government organizations, but 75th when it comes to research institutes globally. And CSIR IICT is one amongst the nine chemistry laboratories under the chemical sciences discipline, and we are one of the oldest and the elderly laboratory, I would say. So what do we do at IICT, for those who do not know, is, you know, we basically, our mandate, as you see in the name itself, scientific and industrial research, we would love to enable the industry through our knowledge and skill set, which is having an expertise in process development for sustainable and cost-effective or green processes and technologies is what we offer to the industry, new product development as well, and also the analytical services. That's as far as the private goods. Otherwise, we, as per the Katoch committee, we distribute our work into four different verticals. Besides the private goods offering our services to industry, we work on the public goods, where we try to develop the HR in terms of PhD students who go and take up eminent positions, not only in India, you know, in institutes of eminence, but also overseas. And we work on several skill development projects, like how Professor Reddanna was telling. Upskilling is very, very crucial, and we have come up and embraced this being a government organization since 2016. We thought we should offer both our expertise and also the infrastructure to the students who would like to upskill. So that's where we are coming up. And strategic goods is always there, because strategic goods, you have the import restrictions for certain strategic materials. So we rise up to their demand of making some indigenous materials, and which are high performance, particularly both to the defense and space sector. And societal goods is something which is very, very crucial and important. as a government organization, we come up with affordable solutions both in waste management, in sanitation, in water, and farmer-centric programs as well. So we align with the sustainable development goals. So we try to create an ecosystem for the startups. We also have several startups incubating on our campus. We publish and we strengthen new emerging areas and create a mark in the niche areas. So if you see our major contributions, I said we are the most elderly institution amongst the CSIR laboratories. Our journey was very interesting. We always had risen up to the demand of the nation. So we were going by the needs of the nation. Although our vision is very clear that we create an outstanding knowledge base in chemistry and chemical technology, we started a journey even before independence. If you see in the 1944, it was established, and over seven decades we had been moving from coal and ceramics to agrochemicals. That is when, you know, IACT came up with several process know-hows in pesticides and for crop protection chemicals, when the nation was suffering from dirt in the food grains, you know, and there was a war between the pest and the man for the food grains. We did not have the self-sufficiency for the food grains, and that's during the Green Revolution we came up with the processes. And then we were into affordable healthcare by coming up with process know-how for several generic drugs. And then we went on to contribute in specialty chemicals and materials, as I already said, for the strategic sector. And then into impurities, drug discovery. And now we are very much focusing on to the repurposed drugs for COVID and others, both in adjuvants and clinical trials and so on and so forth. APIs, of course. So our strength, basically the core competency is we have different disciplines working together, around 160 scientists, 360 support staff, 600 researchers. These could be project assistants and PhD students. And we are having a presence in the fluoro and agrochemicals sector. Fluorochemicals is something which is very unique that is available in IACT only, because all over India we do not have that special facility, a unique facility I would say, to handle fluorinated chemicals. And then organic synthesis and process chemistry, polymers and functional materials, catalysis and environmental engineering. We are hugely supported by the applied biology, analytical chemistry and process engineering, because you need to have scale ups for everything. So I was talking about the human resource that helps us in a big way. From Telangana and Andhra Pradesh, we do have PhD students, and these students are the ones who execute the projects in niche areas on the niche topics. But otherwise, we have project students also. You can see the numbers. So basically, today I would like to focus on the organic synthesis and process chemistry expertise that we have, which contributes majorly to the APIs and KSMs and intermediates process development, and catering to the needs of the pharmaceutical industry particularly. So process development with recent advancements is our forte, where the drugs and intermediates, KSMs and specialty chemicals processes can come out. And this department has just around 40 plus research scientists, and the researchers are all 190. So we come up with simple to complex molecule synthesis, incremental improvement. If you wish to have an atom economy or a greening of the process, we are there to help you out. And the regulatory toxicology, research analytical support. We also give you help the industry in route selection and optimization, multi-step and asymmetric synthesis, flow chemistry, parallel synthesis, biotransformations, photochemicals, reactions, and also natural product isolation. So we are heavily supported by the infrastructure, state-of-the-art infrastructure, I would say, with respect to the X-ray crystallography, electron microscopy, analytical instrumentation, is in chromatography, say anything. We have all of them, and we have the NABL accreditation with ISO 17025, and that's how we are now moving on to GLP compliance as well. We have got a GLP compliance and FDA approval for the NMR facility, and so that also can be taken as an advantage by most of the pharmaceutical companies to come to us for NMR structural elucidation if in case you you require for any of your compounds. We do have a kilolab facility too, which we can offer to most of the industries to come over and make use of it on for upscaling of any of the processes they have, or we use it for our internal utilization. And some of the molecules you can see, the Daclatasvir, Celecoxib, Sildenafil, and Mavococcib, ALA, the alpha lipoic acid, all these things are made in this kilo lab. So this kilo lab was recently established, and I wish that every one of you all, the MSMEs particularly, who do not have access to such facility, are welcome to IACT to take care of that. So we do have upscaling and engineering environmental support to take care of the scale-up of any of the process know-hows that we develop at lab level in the form of process development and scale-up, design engineering, dynamics and optimization and control, intensification of process, modeling and simulation, and so on and so forth. So we will be geared up to give you the basic engineering package or even the detailed design report as per the needs of the industry. We also have a very state-of-the-art animal health facility, so to take care of the toxicity studies, the animal models are listed here, you can see for yourself, and also the efficacy studies and the preclinical biology is something which we take up in all these three areas. And this way, we feel we have a complete setup to work on not just the API synthesis, but also do the animal studies, both in vivo and in vitro, to establish the performance of the drug. So this is how we try to publish patents and publications of a very high impact factor with the kind of skills that we have. But moving on to our journey in healthcare, if you see, we started with generics and then we went on to make a mark at with AZT and Misoprostol, and we went on to drug delivery, which Professor Edana was also talking about, the targeted drug delivery, which has less side effects. And then with using nanoemulsions, and then we went on to drug discovery. We have HDAC and mitoskeletin is already marketed. I'll talk about it. And then we went on to repurpose drugs and other areas of coming up with adjuvants and clinical trials with most of the repurposed drugs, particularly for COVID, because that was really bothering to everyone, even when the vaccines were not out. You know, that compulsory regulatory approvals were not given. So that is when we were trying to come up with every alternative repurposed drug that can be effective in treating COVID. So if you see, these are the different generics that we have the processes available with us in different therapeutic areas. Here the AZT is something which we have to mention very prominently, because when the African nations, the underdeveloped nations along with us, were in need of such a drug during the 90s, you know, Avra, the former director of our institute, Dr. A.V. Ramarao, came up with this process for azidovudine, and Cipla, Professor Hamid, came together to join hands and market this drug, not only in India to the AIDS patients, but also in African nations. So this was made affordable to all these people, which was otherwise very expensive. Same is the case with Misoprostol. This was also taken up by Avra Labs, which was instituted by Dr. A.V. Ramarao. So if you see, the way we work is not just based on the industry's requirement, offering process know-hows or developing and catering to their requirement, but we also have CSR headquarters coming up with mission programs based on the Government of India missions. So in order to heavily not depend on the imports, which my colleague was from Pharmaxil also was talking about, so we came up with an import substitution a mission, which is called INPROTEX, Innovative Processes and Technologies for Indian Chemical Sector. That's the short form of INPROTEX. And these are the list of drugs that we have come up with in generics. And then there are many others which are under freedom to operate. And here, the Daclatasvir, Lepidasvir, Velpatasvir, Nilotinib, and Nicergoling, these are another set of drugs, process know-hows that we came up with. And then in drug discovery, I have mentioned here about the HDAC. So similarly, we came up with a mission two also here to for critical APIs and intermediates. We wanted to contribute by networking with most of our sister laboratories who also work in the area of organic synthetic chemistry, and these are the list of drugs that we APIs that we thought are very crucial for our nation, where our contribution as a process know-how developer is key. So any industry who wishes to have processes, yeah, I was also talking about the HDAC. So HDAC inhibitor, the IACT 108, you know drug discovery takes a very long time of several years before it comes into the market. So this is something which we have patented, and this idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis is an unmet medical need. Sorry for this spelling error there, but this compound was actually can sequentially inhibit the TGF beta mediated fibrotic cascade of events by modulating the HDAC signaling in vitro and in vivo models. We have come up with this particular molecule which can be taken forward by any industry to cure the patients who do not have a proper solution right now for this pulmonary fibrosis. The repurposed drugs, we have several success stories with Cipla Foundation. Cipla, you know, we came up with, it's not Cipla Foundation, it's Cipla. Favipiravir was launched and it was given to most of the patients in the beginning. Remdesivir, firstly, you know, they thought it was chloroquine and hydrochloroquine. Most of my colleagues, they were working during the lockdown on these development of these processes, staying in-house within the campus, or otherwise even including the students. Otherwise, it wouldn't be possible for us to come up with these particular solutions. And if you see the list of other solutions, we have several intermediates that go in for remdesivir, because here the challenge was there were no raw materials coming in from other countries. You know, we had to look at raw materials that are available in domestically and come up with process routes. To that was very challenging. So our scientists were very intelligent enough to formulate routes that are new, and for some we have also patented these processes. So if you see the other success story, this is to Sun Pharma. We had given another unmet medical need was there. You know, this was an NCE, multiple therapeutic potential it had. And so this brought in a lot of laurels to us, I would say. And we are very proud of this particular association with Sun Pharma because of the high revenues that it could generate for us, approximately around 2.4 billion. Plus royalties on net sales. So this included the threshold sales as well as the upfront and regulatory and sales milestone payments. So we received the upfront, and they are now trying to do scale up and third party validation studies. Once that is done, and if the drug is really clicking, then you know they will go ahead and launch it. So we have crossed our fingers, and we think that this will go ahead and become a very good drug in the markets and beneficial to the people at large. So this everyone would appreciate, because I take a lot of pride. If Dr. Ella was here, he would also elaborate more on this. Agonist molecule, which goes as an adjuvant to Covaxin, has been made by IACT. This, if this adjuvant is not there, you know, Covaxin cannot be there. I have administered myself Covaxin. I don't know how many of you all have administered Covaxin and not Covishield, but this molecule was developed at a fast pace, particularly to cater to the requirement of Bharat Biotech, because they've had issues of importing this molecule. So we had to come up immediately at a very short period of time, and inexpensive and indigenous, using the indigenous raw materials. This I'm emphasizing every time, because that had become very, very important during this pandemic. And we came up this process, which is atom economic, cost economic, and environmentally very efficient process. We filed a patent on this, and this molecule we had been supplying to Bharat Biotech. And now we have tied up with some private industries who are going to scale up and manufacture it and continuously supply to Bharat Biotech. So these are some of the clippings you can see over here. So this is a molecule called imidazoquinoline, quinolinone, which goes as an adjuvant. And right now we have several other in collaboration going on with Bharat Biotech, and happy to declare to you, it was also in the news, that we are working together on developing novel vaccine platforms using mRNA, and in which, you know, we have our four verticals. We are coming up with microcarriers that are very important to bind the cells. We are coming up with small molecules that go as adjuvants or any other combinations that has to go into a vaccine. We are also working on developing analytical